Shalom and welcome to Jerusalem Studio. As time fast approaches for the official unveiling of the anticipated so-called deal of the century for the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, one crucial piece in the puzzle is surely going to be the status of Jerusalem. While the dispute over the city could possibly face delay, Jerusalem's significance to both Israelis and Arabs makes it impossible to bypass this issue indefinitely. To analyze this question, we're joined here in the studio by Lieutenant Colonel in Reserve Reuven Ben-Shalom, who is a cross-cultural strategist and an associate at the International Institute for Counterterrorism. Welcome. I'd like also to welcome our TV7 analyst, Mr. Amir Oren, and Mr. Yoni Ben Menachem, who is a Middle East expert and political analyst. Welcome. Mr. Oren, give us a broader understanding on the topic of Jerusalem and the significance in this ongoing dispute.
There are three interrelated issues pertaining to Jerusalem. First, under whose sovereignty, if any, should it be? Secondly, can it be the capital of one or two of the states, Israel and possibly Palestine? And the third one has to do with the religious sites, the holy sites to Islam, Christianity, and Judaism. Now, President Trump tried to cut the Gordian knot by announcing some 18 months ago and then implementing his decision a year ago that he is recognizing Jerusalem as the capital of Israel and moving the American embassy from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem. Actually, what he did was open a bigger establishment in Jerusalem than the consulate, which used to be here, but leaving most of the American diplomats in Tel Aviv because they have to relate to the defense establishment and other important government ministries which are in Tel Aviv. But the Palestinians rejected this announcement, even though the indication there was that it only had to do with West Jerusalem and that East Jerusalem will be left for the process in which Israel and the coming state of Palestine will sign an agreement. And probably because Trump said that every country has the sovereign right to decide where its capital will be, then again the inference was that the Palestinians would be able to set up their capital in East Jerusalem. All of that did not come to pass yet. We have now lost all of President Trump's term up to now. There is no process. There is a disconnect not only between the Americans and Mahmoud Abbas, the president of the Palestinian Authority, but also between Abbas and Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu. What Jared Kushner, Trump's son-in-law and the pivot man on the Palestinian-Israeli peace plan, what he's trying to do is try and import American politics into the international arena. Why American politics? Because of the famous lesson of the 1992 elections between Clinton and Bush, it's the economy, stupid. Kushner is trying to put the economic cart before the diplomatic horses and say, okay, these are the economic benefits which will accrue to whoever takes part in the process. Let's talk economy and benefits first and then get to the political part. It's not going to work.
Colonel Ben-Shalom, I'd like to rewind a bit in history, dating back to actually Abraham, the father of all nations here in the Middle East. When we're looking at specifically Jerusalem, the place where Abraham walked and at some point also reached Mount Moriah, and on that dot or the little hill on the top of Mount Moriah was the encounter where Abraham actually did the whole Akedat Yitzchak, the sacrifice of his son Isaac, which of course was eventually thwarted by the angel and so on, as we know the biblical story. But the Muslim narrative is completely different. That specific place is where Abraham actually wanted to sacrifice his son Ishmael, the father of all Muslims or all Shemite Muslims. And this narrative is a continuum, bringing forward, going forward in time. This is specifically also the place where the Holy of Holies was built, which today we know to be the Temple Mount. So that specific place, when people look at it, both Muslims and Jews, Christians as well, this is a place that signifies the connection between God and man. Is this battle a battle of nationalities, or is this a battle of religion and the connection between God and man, and who controls actually that specific small plot of land that in 1967, you know, the liberation of Jerusalem by the forces under Yitzhak Rabin at the time, they emphasized, Har Habayit Beyadenu, the Temple Mount is in our hands.
It's ours.
Is it ours?
You know, we're probably the first force in history to conquer this place and then not just dismantle all the rest and build our own facilities and, you know, wipe everybody out. We're probably the first force in history that said, you know, we're going to respect all other religions, Temple Mount, you know, with all due respect to our temple that was there. Now we have the mosque that's there and we respect it, and Muslims come from all over the world to see this place. And so we have this status quo there. I think with your question, you demonstrated why this is a hot potato. It's not a hot potato. It's an explosive potato. It's everything. But the most important thing is the religious narrative, and the sensitivities are so powerful that there's no way getting around it. It's not that if we insult Jews, a bunch of Jews are going to go and riot and kill people. Unfortunately, the Muslim world now, if anything goes wrong, and we saw in history that opening a small tunnel in the Muslim quarter, what that can erupt. So it's extremely sensitive. If you ask me, the most important thing is respect of both sides to the other side's narrative. The big issue now is that you phrased your question in a way as if we all have our narratives and supposedly we can respect each other's narratives. What happens today is that Arabs or Palestinians or those in the conflicts tell us, you have nothing to do with here. You made up the history of the temple. We actually disregard all recorded human history. That's it. We don't care about the Bible. We don't care about everything. You're foreigners. You don't belong here. You made it up. Jews make the mistake of saying, you Muslims, you know, you don't even have Jerusalem mentioned in the Quran. By the way, our Muslim friends should know that it's not mentioned in the Quran. It's mentioned once, the farthest mosque interpretation that it's that. But here's the point. Big mistake for Jews and Israelis to try to challenge the Palestinian narrative. We have to respect it. Muhammad went up to the sky on his horse in this place. This is the Muslim narrative. Every Muslim in the world feels for this place, loves this place, cherishes this place. That's why you have to respect it too, which is why there's never going to be a solution that goes to yours or ours or splitting it down the middle of the Burak Plaza or the Western Wall Plaza, as we call it. It will have to be something from respect. It will have to be a genius mechanism, and I'm not sure we'll reach it in our lifetime.
Mr. Ben Menachem, how do you perceive it?
This is the most complicated issue in the conflict, this and the refugee problems. But let's say that we find some sort of a humanitarian solution for the refugee problem. This is something you cannot solve because it's not only the Palestinians that have demands on the Temple Mount or what they call Al-Aqsa Mosque. Also the Jordanians have their claims. And we have to the status quo when Jordan is the custodian of the holy places in Jerusalem, both to the Muslims and Christians. This is based on the peace agreement between Israel and Jordan from 1994. So this is a very delicate problem. And in any future agreement, I think that this status quo will stay. And there will be maybe some security arrangements to make this status quo work, because every once in a while we see that there are violations from both sides, Israelis and Palestinians. So I think this problem cannot be solved, and the only solution is to have a strong security measures which are accepted for all sides in order to keep the status quo. But unfortunately, I don't think that we will get to it, because I don't see the deal of the century bring us to any negotiation with the Palestinians. It's a non-starter as far as they're concerned, and this is the boycotting the meeting in Bahrain, so they're not even willing to start talking about the economic sides, not about the political sides of this peace deal.
Mr. Oren, since Israel took over the Temple Mount, and as I mentioned the statement earlier, Harabayit be'adenu, the Temple Mount is in our hands, the Muslim and Arab leaders immediately demanded status quo ante bellum, the Latin phrase for the way things were before the war, before the 1964 and this 1967 war. In this instance, to what degree, also taking into account the Jordanian peace treaty, where Israel basically relinquished the administrative control of the Temple Mount for the sake of the Muslim guardians of that place, the Jordanian Waqf. In that peace treaty, we see a specific sentence with regard to Article 9, subsection 3, if I'm not mistaken, which states that all parties will do everything possible to work for interfaith relations and will allow freedom of worship and so on and so forth. That's all beautiful, but at the same time, right now, the reality on the ground is if you're a non-Muslim and you want to enter the Temple Mount, which might be the most holy place in your religion or one of the holiest places in your religion, you're not allowed to exercise the fundamental right of freedom of worship. And if you try to do that, whether you're defined extremist or not, you're incarcerated immediately.
The sad part is that much of that was foreseen more than 70 years ago. And that's why people both in the region and outside it, United Nations mediators such as Count Bernadotte, tried to separate church and state, mosque and state, synagogue and state, because there's a difference between Jews who can have any nationality, Israeli, American, French, what have you, and Israelis. There's a difference between Muslims and Arabs, or Muslims and Palestinians, Muslims and Indonesians, and what have you. And those who want to go to their holy sites do it out of some religious belief, not because they are holding a certain passport. Now, you can look at any place which changed hands in history from either perspective, or either I was here first or I was here last. You lost, I won. Now it's mine. You can never get any solution if you try these lines of argument. If you go to Spain, if you go to Sevilla or Cordoba or any other place, and you see cathedrals which became mosques when the Moors conquered the place, and then they reverted to cathedrals or churches when the reconquest happened. The only difference is that the Muslims no longer live in Andalus and no longer have a claim, even though the Islamic State wants to regain control.
Because fundamental ideology of the Quran, which is quite clear in the Quran about that, is that any land that Indeed. Belonged in the past to Muslims will always remain Muslim.
Indeed. So when the British won over Palestine from the Ottomans, they decided to separate excess from sovereignty. They said, okay, Jews and Muslims have conflicting claims to certain sites, such as the Cave of the Patriarchs in Hebron, or Temple Mount. So on certain dates, certain holidays, this particular faith will have priority, on another date, and so on and so forth. Now, the Muslims usually did not respect this arrangement, and therefore we saw riots and we saw massacres before the 1947-48 war started. And as we all remember, in the UN resolution 181, Jerusalem, which tried to establish two separate states, Israel and Palestine, Jerusalem was a corpus separatum, a separate, a third entity under UN supervision. Now, neither side wanted it, and Israel rejected this proposal, and some extremists assassinated Count Bernadotte, but the Jordanians, or as they were called at the time, Transjordanians, also did not want this solution, and they annexed what we now call the West Bank, including East Jerusalem. Now, it is said that Ben-Gurion didn't go out of his way to try and conquer East Jerusalem because he understood the complexity of having to take care of the Muslim sides. So while he always said how much he regretted not having done it, he had a secret arrangement with King Abdullah, the grandfather of King Hussein, or the great-grandfather of the current King Abdullah II, and let it stay.
Who was assassinated in
and
Temple Mount.
And he was assassinated on Temple Mount. But you know, you mentioned 1967 and the joy which engulfed Israel and Jews all over the world when they heard that the Temple Mount was conquered, was liberated. But up to 1967, it wasn't an issue. People in Israel did not clamor, let's go into East Jerusalem, which was just around the corner, and let's liberate it. It was a forgotten place.
Nevertheless, every year in Passover, every Jew around the world says next year in Jerusalem.
In Jerusalem, but not necessarily the
Jerusalem that existed, or the one that they refer to, is that specific old city.
It's the Jerusalem of the mind. It's just like many Christians, many Anglicans have their song, Jerusalem, the city on the hill. It's an idea. It's a concept. It is not necessarily a set of buildings and monuments or relics from ancient
for
history.
Parts of society, but not, we can't exclusively elaborate that
this
for
is
all
the
of
core
society.
Of Judaism.
But not, yes, but not as a policy or a plan. Now our project is to start a war which will never end because the Muslims and the Arabs are not going to let us keep it. So what we have now in Jerusalem for the last 52 years is only an interim arrangement until we have the final peace plan.
Colonel Ben-Shalom, how do you see this?
I think we cannot allow this illusion. Like the Arabs, they're very passionate about their religion and they're fanatics and they're serious and they think long term. So we'd better, give in to our national and religious themes because, you know, who knows what's going to happen. I think you have to understand that we are no less zealots. And if we could dream about a place for 2,000 years and come back, then Jerusalem, I think, is in the hearts of Jews no less than Jerusalem is in the hearts of Muslims.
Let me take this a step further. Each one of us around this table knows someone or has family that fought in the 1967 war, all right? To what degree is that reality where in some kind of deal of the century or deal of the centuries, the parts of Jerusalem will be relinquished to the Palestinians or to someone? Is this not going against all those people who fought and sacrificed for those lands?
Extremely complicated. By the way, sometimes you got to look back and say, people sacrificed, okay, but that was back then. History moved forward. I think that we're not talking about a specific place now that there's a clash of who owns it and there's going to be war forever. If you look at the lines, even though it's very close proximity, what we call the Holy Basin, there are the Muslim holy sites, there are the Jewish holy sites. We have a wall, by the way. All we need is access to the wall. Of course, if Jews will want to go as tourists to visit the temple, I don't think there's a problem. I visited.
Even though the wall is an outer wall of the temple of old.
And
so.
I went into the compound many times with respect to my Muslim friends, and it was fine. I think we could reach a resolution here. I think there is a mistake, and this will sound like a political statement, but excuse me. I think we got to be careful with this narrative that we have of a unified Jerusalem forever and ever. Maybe Israel, maybe Jerusalem won't be unified. Maybe if for the Palestinians, Jerusalem is so important, then maybe they need in their national for their national pride to be able to say Jerusalem is our capital, and maybe East Jerusalem will be their capital, and we could draw a line on the map and reach some agreement. Again, if there's mutual respect, if the Palestinians will accept our very existence here, we want to reach a deal, we will be able to reach a deal. I too don't think we're going to soon see this amazing Trump deal that we're all going to say, amazing, why didn't we think about that before? It's not that easy, but I think it is possible with mutual respect to reach some kind of understanding. And by the way, one more point, it could be that someday this holy basin will be like the Vatican. We'll say it's under the leadership and ownership of God, And there's going to be a special international force with representatives of Arabs and Jews and Christians wearing yellow uniforms and flowers on their hat that they will govern the place. Who knows? It's going to have to be something really genius. But we're human beings. We can move forward and find some kind of mechanism.
Mr. Ben Menachem, how do you see this?
Completely.
Okay.
Because we negotiated about these issues in Camp David when Yasser Arafat and was the head of the Palestinians, and Ehud Barak was prime minister, and President Clinton hosted this summit in Camp David. And I remember this idea of no sovereignty, it will belong to God. Barak offered this to Yasser Arafat. He rejected it. He rejected it. He wouldn't agree. Then Barak offered that you will have the sovereignty up and we will have the sovereignty under the esplanade of the Temple Mount, and he refused. So they want full sovereignty in the Temple Mount, only Muslim sovereignty in the Temple Mount. They wouldn't go for less. And as for the Wailing Wall, as far as they are concerned, this is part of Al-Aqsa. This is the wall of Al-Aqsa Mosque. This is what they believe. So they even want the Kotel. They want the Wailing Wall to be under Palestinian sovereignty. I think 2 years ago or something like that, Jibril Rajoub gave an interview to Channel 2, to Rina Matzliach, and he said...
Domestic Israeli channel.
Yeah, domestic Israeli channel. He said, we understand the sensitivity, Jewish sensitivity about the Kotel, and maybe we'll allow you to have the Kotel. And they almost wanted to assassinate Jibril Rajoub, the Palestinians. This is the senior Fatah who sees himself as the successor of Abu Mazen. So I think we have a big problem here. I don't think that we can solve it. And as I said, we will not get to it even, because even the simpler issues will not be resolved, and we're not even starting the negotiations with Palestinians, because the whole deal of the century, the whole concept is not acceptable for the Palestinians.
Well, Mr. Oren, I'd like to actually follow up on the point that Mr. Ben Menachem stated. Aqsa, the battle cry of the Palestinians, which Abu Amir Yasser Arafat said,
in
all the situations that he spoke about, he always said that with the sword and with blood, we will free Al-Aqsa.
A million shahids are going to Jerusalem.
Exactly. It all surrounds, every time there was a battle, every time there was violence, it all surrounded Jerusalem in general and the Aqsa Mosque in particular. Is this the rallying cry of Muslims living in Israel and in the surrounding areas? And if so, is this the way for them to unify the Muslim world in order to continue their battle for national ideals or what to F you?
Yasser Arafat was a politician, a tactician. He wasn't even religious. He was not only secular, but his rallying cry was for a secular, democratic Palestine in which Jews, Muslims, and Christians we live side by side. And by the way, there are some 10% of the Palestinians who are Christians. Now, most, or at least many, Israelis are secular, and they're interested in security, first and foremost. Of course, they respect the fact that many of their brethren are religious, or for them it's a matter of concern regarding especially the Wailing Wall. But as Yitzhak Rabin said regarding the West Bank, I don't mind going there with a passport. I don't mind going through some checkpoint, showing my passport, and being greeted there. I don't need to be sovereign over the area. I need free access. Now, this is mostly a domestic issue in Israel. Whenever someone from a right-wing party wants to hit at someone from the center or left, he says, he will divide Jerusalem. And the answer is also, I'm not going to divide it, I'm going to share it. We don't have to cut it in half, the way Solomon judged, and then, of course, who was the real mother. Now, the Palestinians or the Muslims have their Al-Quds. Israel has its Jerusalem. In the signs, you can see Yerushalayim in Hebrew, Jerusalem in English, Al-Quds in Arabic. And there can be a solution if people see the larger good, the greater good that we need to coexist here in peace. If there is, as Arafat used to say, if there is a will, there is a way.
Al-Quds referring in Arabic literally to the holy place. Colonel Ben-Shalom, we're drawing near to the end of the program. Where do you see Jerusalem heading to? And is this still going to be the focal point of Arab-Israeli relations?
Unfortunately, yes, for many, many years. And I don't think that Mr. Ben-Nachem and I disagree that much, because everything I said is my dream, my aspiration. But the Palestinians, mostly the Palestinians, are not there yet. In their vision, we don't even exist in the Middle East, okay? So I talk about my Palestinian friends and neighbors and respect and living together, and I agree with everything Mr. Oren said. If the Palestinians would feel the same, unfortunately, they don't. They cling to false narratives, imaginary dreams of throwing the Jews into the sea. So that's not going to happen in the near future. And unfortunately, Jerusalem and the Temple Mount could be the spark that ignites a whole intifada, you may call it, or war with the Palestinians. I just want our viewers to know that someday when they hear that there's a secret conspiracy that Israel is trying to change the status quo, it's a lie, because they use that as a spark to ignite the war.
Mr. Ben-Menachem?
Two effects. I don't know if you know. First of all, there's a church on the Temple Mount under the Solomon stables, a very small church, which is closed. The Waqf closes it. They don't even allow Christians to pray there. This is one point. Second point, you said Al-Quds. The original name of Jerusalem is Bet el Maqdis in Arabic. What is Bet el Maqdis? The temple. What does it indicate? That they refer to the Jewish temple that was on the Temple Mount. But still, we cannot solve this issue.
Indeed. Mr. Oren, last sentence.
The one ray of light, another term that Arafat used to speak about, is that Israelis, even those who want to annex all of Jerusalem, don't want to annex the 300,000 Palestinians who reside in Jerusalem. And only last week, they caught a terrorist with an Israeli residence permit, which means that for security reasons, it is best for Israel to let go of East Jerusalem.
Well, what's best will be left to the leaders of both peoples. This is all the time that we have for today. I'd like to thank Colonel Ben-Shalom, Mr. Oren, and Mr. Ben-Menachem for being here today. And I'd like to thank our viewers as well, and we will see you next time.
You just watched TV7 Jerusalem Studio. We encourage you to pray for the challenges raised in today's program. If you were blessed by our production, please consider supporting TV7 Israel. The details of our respective bank accounts for donations from Europe and the United States appear on the screen. Your generosity allows us to continue to serve God's calling, to broadcast content that truly matters through TV7 Israel from Jerusalem.